Welcome, everyone. Good evening. I'm Tom Landy. I direct the McFarland Center for Religion, Ethics, and Culture here at the College of the Holy Cross. And as many of you know, this semester, in the aftermath of the seditious January 6th attack on the United States Capitol, egged on by a sitting president of the United States, Donald Trump, against Congress and his own vice president, the McFarland Center is hosting a series of discussions titled Repairing the Fabric of Our Nation. Our goal has been twofold. First, to explore the causes and consequences of our political and social division that culminated on January 6th, but culminated really after many, many terrible events that preceded it in ways that have been building up. Second has really been to ask the question of how we repair our way out of it as a country. I think that's essential. You can watch our prior discussions in the series on our website at holycross.edu/McFarland Center. To my mind, the fact that there are too many Republican senators who are startlingly and representatives startlingly at ease overlooking the act of sedition or of treason is something that really can't be overlooked. But we still have to find a way to move forward as a country. I'm not a fan of one-party states. I know that a healthy political future depends on the ideas and commitment of Americans across the political spectrum. So tonight's discussion focuses on conservative ideas and policy goals to repair our political fabric. I'm grateful and pleased to introduce a panel of conservative thinkers from across the Holy Cross community. And I'll just introduce them one at a time before we start. Mary Clare Amselem is a writer and former policy education analyst at the Heritage Foundation. Her research and writing focuses on ways in which free market principles can inform higher education policy. She is host of COVID in the Classroom, a biweekly podcast dedicated to getting kids back into school, putting parents in a position of power in navigating the new world of education in the time of coronavirus. At Holy Cross, she was a political science major, graduating in 2013, and she holds a master's degree in public policy from the George Washington University. Don Brand is professor of political science at Holy Cross and co-director of the Charles Carroll Program. His research includes American politics, American national institutions, and public administration. He's the author of Corporatism and the Rule of Law, a study of the National Recovery Administration, numerous scholarly articles, and he's published in the U.S. News and World Report, Fortune, Salon, The Conversation, and elsewhere. Peter Flaherty is a political strategist and consultant who's advised candidates on campaigns for governor, United States Congress, U.S. Senate, and President of the United States. He was deputy campaign manager and senior advisor to Mitt Romney. Previously, he served as an assistant district attorney in Boston. He earned a bachelor's degree in economics from Holy Cross in 1987 and a JD from the New England School of Law. Peter co-teaches a popular academic internship seminar on political campaigns with fellow Holy Cross alum and former New York Congressman Tim Bishop. Marisa George is a senior, a student at Holy Cross, due to graduate this spring with a double major in political science and psychology. She's been a student in Peter Flaherty's academic internship seminars. She's co-director of student outreach for the SGA, co-chair of the Student College Republicans, a writer for the Fenwick Review, a member of Pi Sigma Alpha Political Science Honor Society, and on the Political Science Student Advisory Committee. Marisa has interned for the Republican National Committee, as well as the Worcester Elections Commission, and is a member of our great election Holy Cross Elections Forum team this fall. We had a lot of fun working together. Tim Rice is associate editor of the Washington Free Beacon. His writing has appeared in the Wall Street Journal, the Washington Examiner, and City Journal, among other places. Previously, he was a public affairs specialist for the U.S. Office of Personnel Management, a senior editor at Keybridge Communications, and Deputy Director of Health Policy of the Manhattan Institute. He was a 2018 Claremont Institute Publius Fellow. He was a political science major and Charles Carroll Fellow at Holy Cross, graduating in 2016. So thanks to each of you for being here. Our audience, our attendees, I invite those of you joining us tonight to submit your questions at any time using the Q&A question. We had questions submitted in advance as well. Tonight's webinar is being recorded and will be posted in a day or two. If you do submit a question, please let me know whether you would like or would not like me to use your name when I ask the question. Some of the discussants I know here tonight, I know as friends, or at least as students whose energy and thoughtfulness I admired, But at the same time, and I'm saying this for our audience because I've warned our discussants already, I don't intend to be easy on them. And I think it's important not to be after 4 years under Donald Trump. There we editorialize. They're bold and they're expecting that. So I hope that they'll make this will make for good conversation. And apparently, as I've learned, one only need read John Boehner's new book or hear Donald Trump's latest comments from Mar-a-Lago to encounter much more biting takes on the Republican Party than I might offer. But one way to think of this conversation is to frame it in Ezra Klein's terms. How do we get a more responsible Republican Party with a real governing agenda? How do we save us from Marjorie Taylor Greene or QAnon or Mo Brooks or Donald Trump? And do you all want us to be saved from that? I trust that our discussants are trying to push the Republican Party in a reasonable policy direction. So I'd like to push the discussion really in a policy direction tonight, even if we have to talk some about some of the truths that allow for reconciliation. Let me start with this, and I haven't warned you about the question, but I guess briefly I'd say, how do each of you diagnose the fragmented state of American public life in 2021? What or who is fundamentally responsible for that? And I'll just let you go in the order you choose. Otherwise, I'll call on you. It'll be like the class.
Ladies,
Tim is afraid I'll call on him. So, Peter, I'll let you start.
Well, I think that the fractured state of really public life right now, I don't think it really can be attributed. I know everyone wants to say, or what you might be trying to bait us to say, Dr. Landy is the former inhabitant of the Oval Office. I just think that that's too simple of an answer. I think it has to do with probably the factionalized parties on both sides. I think we have polarization within polarization. And I think, quite frankly, the factionalization that's going on the Democratic side is probably more rampant and will probably have more negative effects on their party than the Republican Party does going forward. By that, I obviously mean the AOCs and the squad, kind of like what John Boehner referred to in his book. I'm glad you brought that up. I think he talked about his tenure as speaker as being the mayor of Crazy Town. And I think Nancy Pelosi, if she's being candid, would probably say she's the new mayor of Crazy Town.
Marisa, go ahead.
I was going to say, and to build off of that, something you said earlier that I would have to disagree with when you spoke about the January 6th, I think there actually was a very strong response from Republicans in office speaking out against the violence and against what happened at the Capitol. So I do think Republicans do look at what Trump has done and do look at policies of Trump and do want to take away the good from it. And I personally don't know many Republicans who loved the tweets and loved a lot of his personality aspects. I don't think there's a lot of disagreement there, but I do have to push back on that Republicans just want to move on from Trump because despite his rhetoric, there was a lot that he did that I think people do want to look at, such as being tougher on China, looking at the COVID response. And I think there are a lot of questions that have come about in the government as a whole with COVID that Republicans do question Andrew Cuomo versus Governor DeSantis. And looking at that, I think with Republicans looking at from a state versus federal level, I do think that there is a lot of disagreement within both parties. And I agree with Professor Flaherty that I don't know if it's right to say this is President Trump or this is just intra-party debate on both sides.
So the causes, you would say, of the current situation that we're in, of this kind of division that we're seeing? Marisa?
What do you mean? Can you repeat that?
So my opening question was how you diagnosed the fragmented state. Where did it come from?
I do think President Trump coming into office did shake a lot of things up, clearly, as I said. But I also do think that both parties are starting to go further right and further left. So I don't know if there is one set diagnosis. I don't think it's that simple with partisan politics. And I do think COVID-19, there are just a lot within that that I think a lot of people are questioning what the right approach is. And I think that's caused divisions on both sides. So I don't think there's one clear answer of it's Donald Trump or it's this policy. I think there's a much deep-rooted, more complicated answer than just I could give in a two-minute answer on a webinar.
Yeah, I would add that I think it's important to keep in mind that Donald Trump didn't happen in a vacuum. I think it would be a mistake to view Donald Trump as a cause. I think that the election of Donald Trump happened for a reason. And that reason is we have an enormous fraction of Americans who, for a lot of good reasons, don't trust our institutions anymore, have absolutely no faith in our media, in our universities, in our tech companies. And the response to that pushback, the response to those questions is more cramming down on free speech. And so I think that's an enormous problem that has been happening for decades. Without any significant pushback or significant progress made by elected Republicans in Congress. And I think that American people started growing increasingly frustrated with that. And so in order to talk about where conservatives should go from here, I think it would be an enormous mistake to ignore the reasons why Donald Trump got elected in the first place.
But I would like to come back to that, but Tim?
Yeah, one thing that jumps out to me and has jumped out to me as everyone gives their answers is that the increasing partisanship of American politics, I think, stems in part from the increasing politicization of American life. So whether that is the continuous growth of overreach of federal politics and federal issues into state and local issues, or the continuing overreach of federal institutions and agencies into the day-to-day, everyday, you know, increasingly more day-to-day aspects of American life, or, and, you know, obviously these things are all bound together, just the increasing politicization of everything, right? You can't buy a sandwich or listen to music or turn on, pretty much any bit of programming without being hammered with one kind of, one political point or the other. And as this all perpetuates, as more and more of American life falls under the sway of politics, more and more people take a stand, more and more people expect their friends and family and neighbors to take a stand. So there's increasingly little left that we talk about that isn't either directly related to politics or government or that hasn't been in some way politicized. And of course, people are going to start entrenching in their positions because, you know, you have to take a position when it encroaches on all of your life. And of course, some of those positions are going to be sort of blunt and broad and basic, because when you're expected to point to or draw on your position at every single turn, it can't always be a nuanced take on policy or a balanced opinion on something. It's going to be a quick sort of, this is my camp, this is my team, this is my guy.
I ask you to do it in 2 minutes.
I also think, Dr. Landy, just to follow up a little bit, I think we would be naive to not recognize something that's not a politician, it's not a Democrat or Republican, that has really frayed the American psyche over the last year, and that's the coronavirus. No matter where you are, and people are looking, people are upset with the way that life has turned out on a whole lot of fronts. I'm sure we're going to get into it, from the school front and people Zooming and teachers unions, and people want to blame somebody for what's going on in their lives, loss of jobs, and so if you want to blame Governor DeSantis, or you want to blame Governor Kristi Noem, or you want to blame Dr. Fauci. I mean, there's a lot of blame going around, and a lot of it can be pointed back to the coronavirus. Let's not lose sight of the fact, and we could probably have a whole discussion on this, whether or not Donald Trump would have won all 50 states if the coronavirus didn't even happen.
Maybe not 50, I can say that, but whether he would have won, yes. But in a country of self-reliance, I do want to come back to Don on the same question if he wants, or I have a question that I can go to Mary Claire and a follow-up to go with Mary Claire and Tim on.
Sure, let me jump in. Tom is clearly looking for a partisan fight here, and I don't want to disappoint. So I would say the problems are clearly derivative from the Democratic Party. I would go back to the 1970s, post-1968 Democratic Convention, which was a debacle, and they instituted the McGovern-Fraser reforms of political parties, part of reforms that were introduced into the Democratic Party, but were then imposed essentially on the Republican Party. What that did is decisively weaken the role of political elites. So I want to focus on the weakness that political parties have had in recent years. And I would attribute the rise of Donald Trump to reforms where Trump could essentially execute a hostile takeover of the Republican Party over the resistance of many Republican Party elites. So I do think we need, the weakness of political parties is what we need to focus on. And certainly, you know, the Democrats have had their fair share of blame in that process, maybe, you know, more than Republicans.
And Don, I was only going to take it back to the contract on America. So you take it back further. So there we go, if we want to.
I'm still trying to work in Lincoln here, but go ahead.
So let me go back to Mary Claire and Tim, because you're both talking, Mary Claire was talking about lack of trust. But and then Tim came to the politicization of things. So I would argue, and tell me if I'm wrong, that a lot of the lack of trust, you know, in a world where masks have become politicized or vaccines have become politicized, which seems like pretty incredible to me, that it's been politicized by parties in ways that are hard to understand. So, and it's hard for me to wrap my head around why even evangelicals won't take a vaccine that was invented under a Republican president who they admire. But let's put those two things together, lack of trust and politicization, because I think that's the lack of trust didn't come from nowhere. But am I wrong?
Well, I'll just answer like directly what you, the example you brought up. People don't trust the vaccine because people think that if there was any issue with the vaccine, that no one would be empowered to be able to talk about it because they would get shut down on Twitter, because the media wouldn't interview this person, because they think that all these people are in cahoots together and won't give the truth the light of day. That's why people don't trust it. And that's why a lot of people are skeptical of taking the vaccine, because they have no idea if there was something wrong. They have no idea if anyone would even have a platform to talk about it. And so I think that going forward, the number one issue needs to be free speech, because that's the only way anyone would have trust in anything again.
I actually think that the mask example is the more illustrative example, because if you go back to a year ago now, right, and you look at what was happening, right, masks are a very common sense solution to things, right? So there's this airborne disease that everyone's afraid of. You want to cover your face. And what was the immediate reaction of public health officials, politicians from both parties, both sides of the aisle, both ideological stripes? They said, don't wear masks. That's dumb. Wearing masks is dumb. You shouldn't do it. It's bad. It could be counterproductive. They didn't just say a moderate kind of, let's be careful. We want to save those masks for, you know, nurses and doctors. They did to a certain extent, but they hammered down this hard, fast position. And then 3 months later, they reversed it and they said the other thing. And now people are imperfect. Public health experts are certainly imperfect. We want people to revise their opinions as we learn new facts. We want, you know, information to come to the surface. We want to adjust our things. But of course, people are going to find, of course, some group of people is going to begin to doubt when it goes from you absolutely should not wear a mask to you absolutely have to wear 3 masks in a matter of months. One group of people is going to doubt that. The other group of people is going to use it as a political cudgel against them. And then again, it's right back to everything's politicized.
So what Donald Trump did about this had no impact.
I'm sorry?
So what Donald Trump said or did about masks had no impact then?
No, I'm sure it had some impact, okay. It wasn't just Donald Trump is what I was saying. So, Trump and Jerome Robbins, and it was, or Jerome Adams, Jerome Robbins is a musical composer. It was everyone.
Let me take you to a fundamental question that's very important to me. I mean, Mary Claire, your friend, Professor Klinghardt and I are going to do something on free speech next semester, so you can tune in on that. We are in favor of that. But the trust question is one that's also fundamental to me, sort of how in our society today then, how can conservatives help restore a proper level of trust? Sort of what can we do from your perspectives that can build up trust? Because I do think that is one of the fundamental questions actually in our culture today. Wherever you blame it coming from, how do we begin to fix that together?
Well, sort of going back to what, you know, Professor Bram was talking about, I mean, the left has been initiating a hostile takeover of all of our institutions for decades. And so we need to sort of go back and initiate free speech back into those institutions. And if we want conservatives to have any place in the future, then we need to slowly start to work our way into those institutions. I don't mean to sound like a broken record, but I don't think any of that gets done without free speech. And I think that any elected members of Congress who don't come out against the big tech companies and what they're doing, who don't come out against, quite frankly, a completely one-sided voice in our universities, a one-sided voice in our media, even baseball, you can't watch baseball anymore. You can't watch football anymore. Sports used to be this like sacred institution in American life. And now that's been completely politicized, to go back to Tim's point. And so that's how I think we start to initiate trust again, is when people feel like they're represented in their institutions again.
Also, if I could add to that, I think an important topic we didn't discuss with the vaccine is to remember when Joe Biden was running, he said he did not trust the vaccine that was made under President Donald Trump. And then right when he got elected, President Joe Biden, VP Kamala Harris were quick to get the vaccine. And now there's a lot of rage from the Democrat Party of anti-vaxxers on the right, when just a few months ago, it was the Democrat Party that said, well, I don't trust it. It was made under President Trump. How do we know he followed the protocols? Even though it wasn't President Trump in a lab making the vaccine, it was, of course, the same exact companies that are now the ones distributing it. So I think there's also something to be said that with the Democrat Party having such a flip-flop like that and not taking a step back and looking at that and saying, well, President Biden, now just a few months ago, you said you didn't trust it, but now you're encouraging everyone to take it. Why should people trust this vaccine when you have flipped so adamantly on it, when your only reasoning before was not that we didn't know the science, but it was, I don't trust it because of President Trump. So conservatives will look at that and say, well, why should I trust it if you didn't trust it before? So there's a constant back and forth that I think this free speech needing to be there is so both sides can openly express their views and be able to do it in a fair manner that they then can take a step back and actually, as everyone says, follow the science. It's impossible to just objectively look at one thing. So I think you can't ignore Republicans and Democrats alike politicize everything, but I think the vaccine is unfair to say that it's Republicans politicizing when Democrats have been doing it for months.
So I'll agree. I took a vaccine developed under President Trump because I trusted the deep state, or at least Tony Fauci on the question. So, because all this talk about free speech sounds to me a little bit like a culture war issue. It doesn't sound to me quite like policies. What's the policy that you're leading with on this? Because now we're back into talking about media elites and things like that. Where's the policy that conservatives will lead us through on that? What will we change from that point of view? If we talk about cancel culture and free speech and not free speech, to me, we're into kind of culture wars land rather than leading by policy.
Well, I don't know. I disagree. I think that's about as policy can get when you're talking about the First Amendment.
Well, the First Amendment is that the government can't refuse to let people speak. And I think that what we're talking about here is about whether the media speaks the truth or something like that. And that to me is a culture war issue.
Well, I do think speaking as a young conservative and when social media is such a prevalent way that my generation gets their politics, I think the importance of free speech falls under the encouraging of actual dialogue and free speech, not the encouragement of letting one side tell the other what's true and what isn't, letting all this censoring happen on Twitter and Instagram and everything going on. So I think it overlaps a lot, especially, as I said, for my generation, where a lot of kids do get their information from these online tech companies. And I think a lot of students especially don't understand actual policy issues because there is that divide of not being able to get the information. So I think it's kind of hard to not speak on it because that is the first step, making sure that we don't have that divide in the first place, or that barrier, I guess you could say.
I'll give just
go ahead, Tim.
Thank you, Professor. Just two quick actual policies that come to mind in terms of free speech. One, Mary Claire already referenced, which is, I don't even want to say regulation of, because I don't want to stake my claim to a particular solution, but what are we going to do about the tech companies, right? When the private companies, I like private companies, I think they should have a degree of freedom to do what they want, but when Amazon is just yanking books from, you know, noted credentialed scholars off the shelves because they don't like the viewpoint expressed therein, when Facebook and Twitter are shadow banning accounts and posts and things like that. That's, we should have some sort of policy to deal with that, I would think. And then the other is you know, the I'm forgetting the name of the legislation, but you know, there not 230, that I'm talking in higher ed, right? And in education. Now we're, you know, the Democrats have introduced this bill where it's going to limit federal funding. Any institution of higher learning or any kind of learning that gets federal funding has to subscribe to a certain position on gender and sexuality and things like that, which, again, not to get into the culture war side of things, but I think that, as you know, conservatives, we might want to not do the opposite, right? Not so not just the full culture war conservative position of things, but again, using policy to carve out these common institutions, these common places, right? So things like internet marketplaces, social media sites, public colleges and universities should be truly open and as neutral as possible, not so beholden to one thing or the other. And I don't think the solution to that is to yank control of them away from progressivism and hammer it down into conservatism. I think it's getting back to this middle ground of you know, sort of regulating or deregulating and striking that middle of where these are common grounds.
Yeah, I think it's essential for conservatism moving forward is to make sure that we're defining who we are and who we're not. And I think we got into this mess where we're losing a lot of these culture war issues because we completely lost sight of who we were and what we were fighting for. And who we're not, who I'm not, is a libertarian. And that's, it's important to state that when coming back to the big tech issue. Conservatives and libertarians think very differently about this, and conservatives are our own thing. And I think for a very long time, conservatism and libertarianism, we like free markets, we're all, you know, big economists over here. I think that's sort of conflated what we were fighting for and who we are as conservatives. Don't like libertarians.
Can you flesh out a little bit, for if there are students who don't know that difference between libertarians and the kind of conservatism you're talking about?
Sure. Well, by libertarians, I mean free market fundamentalists. So we believe in free markets because we believe that that's the best way to ensure liberty, right? But when that's not true, then it's important to step in. And the big tech issue is exactly where that's not true. You have big tech companies that in many ways are more powerful. Google is more powerful than most countries on earth, maybe even our own. And so it's almost ridiculous to think of that private company the same way you would think of Peloton as a private company. I mean, we're just talking about apples and oranges here. But you know, the libertarian answer to that is that Google is a private company and we can't do anything about that. If you have a company that is so powerful that is controlling what people have access, the information people have access to, and therefore what they think about the world, I think that that's an enormously powerful issue that we can't be libertarians about.
One of the things I would just follow up on that, one of my concerns, for instance, with Twitter taking Trump off is that, you know, Trump is now looking for alternative forums by which he can communicate with his supporters. And we've already seen an increasing sort of tunnel vision polarization within media markets, cable news, conservatives watch Fox, liberals will watch MSNBC. You know, if we go further in that direction in social media, so that Twitter becomes essentially the left-wing social media, and we have some new conservative alternative, then the ability to communicate between conservatives and progressives is going to be even further impeded.
So let me ask you, we were talking beforehand that none of you wants to run for office. I don't know, Marisa didn't exactly check in on that, but suppose by some fluke of nature, each of you had been put in office and you were in Congress. Give me a policy that you would, a sort of new conservative policy that you would bring to the fore right away and want to rally your fellow conservatives around and the rest of America around. What would it be? You're in Congress, so it's something you're going to put in place that's...
Well, for me personally, I would overnight give school choice to every kid in America. I think that that's extremely important. There couldn't have been a greater advertisement for the school choice movement than during this pandemic when parents are stuck in public schools that are not opening with teachers who won't go back to school. Kids should be able to go to whatever school they want to regardless of the pandemic, that's certainly been important now. And this gets back to a lot of the culture war issues, you know, the takeover of these institutions. Parents shouldn't be forced to send their kids to a school where teachers are teaching something that goes against their values. So for me, it would be school choice easy.
I think right now with the crisis on the borders, immigration reform needs to be done. I think the fact that when Trump was in office, everyone was screaming about kids in cages, and now the numbers are skyrocketing and nobody's talking about it. I think it's really important to cover at the border that a lot of these people may be looking for asylum, but there has to be a better way to approach this than just the encouraging of all of them coming over the border and kids getting separated and kids being snuck over. That I think that's an issue that needs to be talked about more.
Can you say a little more precisely? Because we probably agree at that level and may disagree when you get down to details. So what's the...
Well, I do agree that the Biden administration is looking at continuing building the wall. So I do think having it be stricter on the border to get into the country is one huge step that Trump started that I think people are starting to realize maybe there wasn't ill intentions with that and that it really is for the betterment of Americans, but also the families at the border.
I would agree with Mary Claire, just especially given the time right now. I mean, if you're talking, Tom, if in fact we were in Congress, if in fact we were an elected official, what we would focus on, what I would focus on as a general rule would be, you know, let's say you're in the House and, you know, for better or worse, when you're in the House, you're constantly running for re-election. So I would be looking to something that I think would resonate with all of the electorate. I think right now there's no hotter issue than, like I said before, the coronavirus in general. But when you drill down to any specific issue, any specific sub-issue that the coronavirus has basically brought into the households of every American is the school choice issue. Who dictates when it's okay to get back into the classroom? I mean, and I would just try to keep it simple too. People are angry with what has happened inside their own homes, and I think it's refocused them, or maybe focused them at the first instance on the issue of school choice. I think.
So that's why, Peter, we are going to put you and Mary Claire on the same ticket someday. So, Tim,
I would revive any number of efforts at finally actualizing some meaningful conservative healthcare reform. I might be biased because I'm a healthcare guy by training, but one thing that worries me about, or one thing that I have my eye on, the future of conservatism in the Republican Party in the country is I'm skeptical of this growing statist temptation, this notion that the left has had executive orders and the bureaucracy under their control for 50 years. And so enough trying to fix that system. Let's get the executive orders. Let's get the bureaucracy. I think, you know, again, with moderation, right? I think working within the bureaucracy, working with executive orders, all is, you know, reasonable, legitimate tools of public policy is fine. But I think that there is a growing temptation both in DC and sort of across the country for so-called conservatives to just say like, yeah, let's just get more entitlements and more government control of things. Just our way. And I think that one way to buck that trend is to revive healthcare reform efforts, because healthcare is for so many people the bit of government funding and government programming and the bureaucracy that they interact with the most, whether it's Medicaid.
Would you be more specific? Because I'm still waiting for that Republican healthcare alternative to Obamacare.
Sure. I mean, so I'm of the mind that we shouldn't, at this point, repealing Obamacare obviously hasn't worked. And I think there are a number of things that you could do to work within the Affordable Care Act. One of them is passing a law that would give greater flexibility to states to tinker with their own state level ACA programs, which we don't need to go into because it's wonky and boring. But there's a section within the Affordable Care Act that lets states actually, as long as it's budget neutral, they can sort of swap out pieces for different things. California can use these waivers to make their healthcare program more progressive. Texas could use this to make it more market-based. And the idea is that you don't impose a top-down vision on all 50 states. You let different states sort of act as laboratories of democracy, as we like to say. You let them, you know, try out what works. Pilot programs, different states can see. So, you know, you sort of
get... Like Romney care.
Like Romney care.
And we see how that works. And then, yeah. Okay. Don? You're muted.
Okay. Yeah, I would like to see a streamlining of government regulatory processes. That would be particularly useful, by the way, because I do think there is really some hope that if Democrats would stop defining infrastructure as everything under the sun, that we actually might get a bipartisan infrastructure bill. And those jobs are not going to be shovel ready. Part of the reason that they take so long, even for roads and bridges, is simply because of the regulatory burdens that that impede, rapid development. And as part of that, especially removing some of the burdensome government regulations, I think the Republicans should begin championing nuclear power as an alternative to fossil fuels, so that we can make our contribution to a green environment, but without embracing the Green New Deal, nuclear power is the most cost-effective, non-polluting alternative to fossil fuels. So let's get back to building nuclear power plants.
Okay, so we've got some issues there. Let me go to some questions that came in, and one relates to, in a way, one that I framed before, but Liam Donovan from the class of 23 would like to know, having listened to mixed messaging by the president and many Republicans in Congress on issues like COVID-19, I know we did talk about that, and climate change, a lot of people have lost faith in the scientific community. How should conservatives go about restoring the faith, and how should conservatives address the issue of climate change if the market is encouraging products that use renewable energy sources, such as electric vehicles and solar panels? So we may have touched the COVID side of it. How would you touch the climate change side of it around science? Don started there, so that pushed me towards that question.
Well, I would, Tom, rather than look like the party of no, just to be able to kind of like what Tim was saying about healthcare, to just say, okay, we're not going to throw out everything. Let's just pick out a couple of things and just agree that this, just not to get very basic on this, but just agree that it's an issue. And I mean, as sad as that is, that actually might even be some progress.
Yes.
And then say, okay, how much is this going to cost? And then talk a little bit about the market, talk, and then come with some data and say, okay, the fact that the Green New Deal is going to expand the size and scope of the federal government too much, that it's going to crush middle class families and that kind of stuff, and come at it with data, but not just, don't be so dismissive of science writ large. I think that's where the debate kind of the debate gets squelched, and I think we lose credibility if we don't at least come to the debate saying that this is an issue that should be addressed. We just differ on how we get there.
Okay. Anyone else? I like that answer.
I think that sort of similarly, on the broader, even national level, not giving into the sort of fiery rhetoric that environmentalists on the left so often engage in, because I think we can agree that it is an issue. And there are, there is a lot of data on the conservative side of things. I'm putting it in quotes because it shouldn't be the conservative side of things, right? It shouldn't be an inherently conservative position to say that, fracking is obviously not, it's not equivalent to not fracking, because that doesn't make sense. But it's not as bad for the environment. It's not going to blow up the earth, right? It's not going to release pollutants into everyone's drinking water. It shouldn't be a conservative position to simply and calmly and honestly state the facts and the logic behind certain policies that are Republican Party policies, because the Democrats have sort of given way to the environmental side of things. So I think because even the facts are considered so polarized in this debate, I think there is a temptation to just sort of, double down, make fun of the Green New Deal and defend America's fossil fuel companies. And though there is a lot, I think, to make fun of and a lot to defend in those respective cases, I think that sticking, really holding tightly to the reins of the actual policy case is something that is important for us to continue to do.
Okay. I have a lot of other questions, so if anyone wants to jump in, tell me. But there are a couple of questions related to social media, and I'll ask both of those. This is coming from a guy who doesn't watch any cable TV except when I used to be stuck at the gym on the Stairmaster, but I can't go there because of COVID. And I don't do any social media. But two of our people sort of want to ask you about the effect of that. What part is social media, including television networks, played in the radicalization of the GOP, and how far back does it go? Or what level of impact do you think digital platforms have complicated or exacerbated the partisanship, curated the conversations, and deepened the rifts?
Well, I think it's right there in the question, curate the conversation. Social media companies are not meant to curate conversations. They're meant to be, you know, forums of public debate.
The first question is interesting because it calls to mind all the typical arguments about Fox News and Roger Ailes and Drudge and all these things. And I think the thing that I always want to bring up when someone discusses the effect of social media or just cable news media on the right is as a counterpoint, you know, the general media on the left, right? That's you don't need to go to Fox News or to, you know, President Trump's Twitter page or something you don't need to go to the left equivalent of those things to get sort of mainstream or even sort of eclipsing the mainstream progressive views, because it's in, you know, it's in network television programs, certainly, and, you know, movies and TV shows on streaming services, which I'm not necessarily, I don't object to as a rule. I don't think, you know, again, we shouldn't like make those illegal, but, you know, did cable news make the right a little bit more polarized? Sure. Did everything else on television make the left a little bit more polarized? Absolutely. Does the media have a polarizing effect? Sure. But at the end of the day, it's the media, right? It's a medium. So I ultimately sort of think that, you know, there are certain things that we can do to sort of, again, make common spaces more equitable, make sure that, you know, free speech can flourish where it's a forum for conversation. But at the end of the day, like, short of passing, you know, some renewed version of the fairness doctrine that bans cable news, which I don't think we should do, like, the media is just sort of, it's we're stuck with it.
I'm a child of three or four television stations that came in over the antenna, and that was it. So it was a different world. So let me ask this question from an anonymous attendee. Something in common with me as an ex-conservative myself, I want to ask, what would be required for any of you to take leave of conservatism or even the Republican Party? What's your limit principle?
$2 million.
You might hope it's a rich questioner.
Yeah, no,
I have a feeling I know who it is, actually, but
I hate
you
to
can tell me later.
Back. I hate to speak back to back, and apologies to my other panelists, but I would just like to quickly offer my two cents as an ex-liberal, as someone who entered Holy Cross as a MSNBC loving Barack Obama voting liberal. And now I, you know, have done stints in free market think tanks and in the Trump administration. I think that I don't see going back as outside the realm of possibility, but in you know, in the broadest way of things. But I think really it's the sort of free thought and free speech, right? That's one of the things that really initially tickled my fancy on the right was, you know, there were certain, it was becoming clear to me on campus and just in the world in general, that there were certain thoughts that you couldn't even entertain, certain things that you, certain truisms that you had to uphold. The big one for me was just like, I've always loved the American founding, and I've always been very interested in studying the founding and those principles. And I wanted to do that. And it started to become clear to me that if I wanted to stay in the party that I was at and the movement that I was at and hold the internships that I've been holding, that I just couldn't think those things anymore. And it's not that I was so doctrinaire convinced of my position, but I was very uncomfortable with, you know, this notion that there were certain things that just were beyond the pale that weren't really beyond the pale, right? Like liking John Adams shouldn't be beyond the pale. So I'll consider coming back when the left sort of lifts the prohibition on groupthink and rightthink.
So I always said with Don, I mean, Don, who I will out as an ex-liberal and me as an ex-conservative, we actually thought of one time talking about the kind of conversation you're just trying to have right there. But I will say sort of, to stick with the question that the questioner put in, what's your red line? What would chase you away? What's your limit principle to take leave from conservatism? Because there are certainly times I wondered under Trumpism, you know, well, that's got to finally chase people away, and didn't see it happen. I didn't make up the question.
it chased me away.
It did. I know that, Don.
I'm still advisor to the College Republicans. I'm still a Republican. I'm still a conservative. But I do think that Donald Trump represents a kind of cult personality, and he can succeed over the next 4 years, which I have some fears about, in expelling people like Liz Cheney and Mitt Romney from the Republican Party, Lisa Murkowski, moderate centrist figures, then I guess functionally I've become a Democrat. I don't know.
Also, I think there's
greatly about that.
I was going to say, I think there's a huge difference between asking conservatism versus the Republican Party, because I think conservatism is one question of what conservatism stands for. But then if the Republican Party changed their platform and became less conservative, I think is more likely the question of would you leave the party, rather than I think what conservatism represents is a reason that we're in the Republican Party. I don't want to speak for the panel as a whole, but I think it would be if the party got less conservative is what would make me more likely to leave the party.
So I would say, answering back, that Donald Trump crushed a lot of conservative things that the party once believed in and left them as detritus on the highway, but the people still stayed along with them. But we can come back to that if you want, or we can take it some other time.
Let me ask you this, Tom, not to answer a question with a question, but what was your red line that made you now self-identify as a former conservative?
My red line was around the culture wars, really, the way that I found the party quite willing to demonize and destroy other people over culture war issues in order to achieve power. And I watched that happen over time, and it chased me away. Marissa's seen the pictures of me as the, you know, young college Republican head or whatever. And certain things I haven't changed my mind on. My difficulty with Democrats is still around abortion politics. But other than that, you know, it's sort of, I would call myself someone who's been chased away. But that's a different story, I suppose. Yeah.
It seems like the Democrats are engaged in the culture wars just as much. When you talk about the fact that they don't welcome pro-life Democrats like they used to, and you see people like, you know, Joe Biden.
So I'm a registered independent, just to leave that side alone. Yeah. Let me go to another anonymous question. What are your thoughts about the new infrastructure bill?
6% of it has to do with infrastructure.
I give it 20, but keep going.
Well, I don't know if it was Dawn earlier that said they everything from iced coffee to going to a baseball game is considered infrastructure these days. Actually, no, going to a baseball game, you're not supposed to do that. But
you can still go to golf.
All right. Nobody wants to take that up. What's your response to those who say that ignoring government regulations is what caused the recent energy crisis in Texas? I'm not making these up, and there are lots more like it, so somebody should answer something.
Well, there's some truth to that, but it's also true that, government regulations may not be the solution either. Government has a pretty bad track record of trying to manage energy in this country, so.
Yeah, I don't want to. I was sort of embarrassingly uninformed about that situation. I will mea culpa that one. So I don't want to bloviate on it, but I do think that even if that were the case, sort of to echo what Professor Brand said, regulations are not the most flexible things all the time. They can be, but they often aren't. They're often outdated and short-sighted and counterproductive. And so I think, you know, the notion that more regulation would have fixed that, maybe different regulation, but you know, it's sort of this, it could equally be the case that there were bad regulations in place and people were rigidly following them, and that led to, that leads to a crisis down the line, right? Especially with something as man-made and inflexible as regulation, and something as fickle and unpredictable as catastrophic weather events. That's, you know, it's sort of a roll of the dice.
What's your response to those who say that cancel culture is not about stifling free speech, but is about being respectful and conscious of the inequities that have existed for so long in this country as an attempt to correct those.
I think we hear that a lot, right? Like, because no one's against cancel culture, but then the people who end up doing the canceling are saying that they're pro-accountability culture. And that's fine on the easy issues, like, you know, you shouldn't be horrible to people, you know, you shouldn't tweet, you know, horrible things. But that gets a little dicier when it comes to things that, you know, one side might see as morally okay and the other side might not see as morally okay. You know, we don't necessarily always agree on these things, and that's okay. It becomes an issue when you have people getting fired from their jobs for things that, you know, they might see for saying something that's in line with their values, but isn't in line with, you know, the values of, you know, the corporate elites. So that's where it gets a little dicier. You know, we can all agree, you know, to say horrible things to people on Twitter. That's, you know, pretty easy, but then we're calling that, you know, accountability culture, not cancel culture. So it's standing up those issues where people are, you know, voicing their values and living true to those values.
Roseanne Fitzgerald says, thanks for a great conversation. An issue that's very close to my heart is the issue of immigration at the border, which I know we've touched on already, but here's a twist. Do any of you have suggestions that help strengthen the countries in Central America?
Just a bunch of domestic policy people on a panel. This is a curveball question.
I think the fact that none of us have an answer is exactly the problem.
You've gotten more questions than I get on almost any other one. Our two congressmen and a senator didn't get this many questions. So, you know, you're.
Neither did Dr. Fauci.
Well, we worked those out with the students. Yeah, he got 12 of those. We had that set.
I think on a broad level, that sort of reorienting our focus away from reorienting our focus towards making things better for those countries, and not just dealing with the residents of those countries in our minds and in our policy thinking once they get to the border, right? So much of this cover, like the implicate, we're debating should we let them in, should we not let them in, but the sort of assumption undergirding that, right, is that something has to be driving them out, right? They have to either be leaving something or going to get something. And I feel like too little of our thinking is, how do we help them get rid of the myriad things that they're fleeing, or how do we help them replicate the myriad things that they're chasing after? I think that there's, as Mary Claire said, there's sort of a dearth of that thinking on both sides of it, because again, it's become this sort of blunt instrument to sort of hammer each other with, either, you know, build the wall or you know, tear down the borders. But I think that just as a basic level, getting back to actually discussing like international aid and you know, America's place in the world, and not just retreating into this sort of neo-isolationist position, is a start.
Anthony Cash asks, what is a practical solution Republicans can take to fight against big companies punishing conservative states for their certain policies like voting reform? Many of these large companies have provided many jobs to growing states like Georgia and Tennessee. So how can state-level Republicans fight back without losing economic growth?
Well, for one thing, conservatives may have to exercise some economic muscle here and threaten boycotts of their own. I think send a reminder to corporations that they should keep their distance from political decisions, because they're going to alienate one side or the other. And they may be beginning to see that Coke and Delta, you know, may have some economic repercussions from their stand in Georgia.
Don, I have to ask, when you say that, does it shake your mind as much as it does mine, that I used to think of Republicans as the pro-business, sort of pro-Chamber of Commerce party, and suddenly things are a little turned upside down, but...
Well, that's, to a considerable extent, that's true, and part of it is the changing nature of business, and part of it's the changing nature of the Republican Party, which has grown increasingly working class and populist. And those two can be very difficult to reconcile.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, I didn't mean.
Companies are getting increasingly involved in stakeholder capitalism instead of shareholder capitalism, and that's a whole other issue. And you know, they are broadening their scope to include all of these social justice missions, and it gets to a point where people are wondering whose interests are most important for the shareholders, whose interests are most important for these CEOs. And like Don said, when these CEOs and these companies begin to get too political, because right back to what Tim was talking about, how, you know, everything in America has become so politicized, the politicization of everything, including, like Mary Claire was saying, at Major League Baseball games. So I think once people do start to exercise their choice to choose one company over another, or to not invest in certain companies, you know, maybe that's what's going to send people a message.
Yeah, and I think that with the position that Brand was laying out, I don't think there's anything anti-business about it. Anti-business would be to say that, you know, lawmakers in Georgia should pass a law saying that the Atlanta Braves can't play in the state of Georgia anymore, right? But that would be anti-business. Pro-business is, you know, the MLB can do what it wants, Coke can say what it wants, but public figures can then get up and say, you know what, Coke, this annoyed me, I'm going to drink Pepsi. And, you know, if you're like me, you're going to come drink Pepsi too. And then maybe, you know, 50,000 people become Pepsi drinkers. Maybe Coke feels it, maybe they don't. But I mean, this is all within the market. This is all within the realm of free businesses, free consumers voting with their dollars, to use a term that I kind of hate.
And maybe the MLB would have a little more credibility if they would stop thinking about expanding their market in China and maybe focus a little bit more on human rights abuses over there.
Trying to find one last question that we can use to wrap, but we have 17 more of them or something like that. So from pretty different sides, but some of them we've covered, touched on some of the issues. Well, Professor Klinghardt, who uses his name there, has asked, would it be better or worse for the GOP for Trump to be nominated in 24? So I'll let him put you guys on the spot.
I think it would be best if the GOP put forward someone associated with Trump, but not Trump himself. I do think Trump has gotten so into the party at this point that you can't separate that there are some people that are diehard Trump Republicans, and that's who they want to vote, and they would never vote a never Trumper. So I think someone like a Nikki Haley or a Ron DeSantis, who is associated with Trump enough that they could get the Trump support and they could rally that Trump rhetoric a little bit, but still be able to appeal to those moderates, I think is the best interest of the Republican Party.
I have to agree with Marisa. As a never Trumper, I've already decided not to run in 2024 because I just don't think I could capture the nomination.
I think that the inherent flaw that was coming with Trumpism, you know, to preserve some of the policies that he wanted to put in place, was that there was no plan for afterwards, and there was no plan for some of the pushback from the left that we knew was building for 4 years. And so I personally think that running again would just delay that inevitability, that there needs to be a long-term plan for conservatives. And, you know, whether or not that involves Donald Trump, I don't know, but I think that we as conservatives or Republicans, whatever you want to call it, need to start thinking about what comes after Trump. That probably should involve tapping a new party head.
Yeah, I think that sort of a version of what Marisa said, I think that we need maybe not even someone who's affiliated with Trump. I would quibble with that, or I would be hesitant on that point, just because I'm a little worried about just any sort of dominant figure in a party having reigned for too long, right? I'm fine with it being the party of Lincoln, but maybe not the party of Trump. And again, I worked in the Trump administration. That's not to say anything, you know, about the Trump presidency here or there. But I think that someone who can begin what I think is going to be a long and difficult process of extricating political strategies and policy goals that happened both in the Trump administration and just throughout the Trump era, that are good and you know, and drawing those out, following those, coming up with other new good ideas that might not be affiliated with anybody, with any wing of the party, just someone to get back to the sort of task of governing and campaigning in as normal of an atmosphere as we possibly have these days.
I think it depends on what happens in the midterms. And I do think that people need to remember that 74, 75 million people voted for Donald Trump, and they voted for Donald Trump's policies, and they voted to affirm what he had done in his 4 years, the good things that he had done, which quite frankly, he probably should have talked a little bit about on the campaign trail a little more than some of the things that he continued to harp on. I think with coronavirus, the fact that he was able to garner the support that he did, I think Joe Biden almost lost an immensely winnable race. And I think that but for a certain small dose of political self-sabotage on the president's part, I think he, despite the coronavirus, almost won this thing. So I do think to say that the entire conservative movement or the entire Republican Party has to totally rebrand itself to win in 2024 is missing the mark. It's not answering the question, because I'm just not sure if Donald Trump, after the 2022 midterms, is going to be in that position to be the standard bearer again.
So I have 19 questions left. I said we'd end at 8 o'clock, and I'm not going to go to the 19 questions. I also have a couple critiques that I've been too hard on you from the left. Supposedly, though, I like to think I come from the middle, but you can tell me afterwards where you think I come from. So let me ask you this. I mean, there are questions around global trade, about inequality, about the environment still, about values. Take one of those things and sort of make the big case. I've stuck you to policy, but a visionary case for conservatism moving forward. Can you do that just briefly? Like, this is what I'm valuing, and this is why I would stay, and this is why some Holy Cross students listening to you now should pick Republican, conservatism, whichever you want. And Don, you've stayed with it despite your anti-Trumpism, so maybe I'll make you start. Like, what's the thing, what's the vision that makes you stay?
I think the core of my conservative ideas is that I do think limited government is the foundation of human liberty. And there's a kind of glorification of the state that is associated with progressivism, especially if you go back to the progressive era. My continuing recognition that government is can be dangerous and is very frequently ineffective. Those are sort of core conservative beliefs going forward.
Okay. Mary Claire?
Sure. I mean, I just kind of going back to what I said at the very beginning, we need to define who we are and who we aren't. And I just think conservatives going forward need to be very clear that we're the party of America, of the American way of life, of the American dream, of preserving those pathways to, you know, life, liberty, pursuit of happiness, all of that. And we're not for being ashamed of America. We're not talking about, you know, like, we were all sort of drawn to conservatism because we really just found the founding of this country absolutely fascinating and something that worth fighting for. So focusing on that, focusing on freedom in all areas, freedom in education, religious liberty, freedom of speech. I mean, really focusing on the fact that we are the people who believe in freedom, freedom how to raise your kids, freedom how to worship your God. That touches on all aspects of life. And I think that very narrowly defining that in the politicians that we elect, it would be a good path forward and the only successful path forward that I can see. But if we go back to, you know, this very wishy-washy, you know, talking about free markets that doesn't really resonate with a lot of people, and really going back to, we believe in freedom, that's why we believe in free markets. I think that's the strategy that we need to adopt.
Tim, you look like you wanted to jump in a couple of times.
Sure, yeah, I would just, my two quick reasons for why we should stick with it and why others should join us is, the first is, everyone sort of alluded to it, the conservative movement is the movement that has held the closest to and continues trying to grapple with our country's founding principles, which I think are still our best guide forward. And I say grapple with because I don't think it's ever a set issue. I think it's we're constantly working these things out, figuring out how to, you know, adapt them to different times and best live up to them. And it's not that you know, I don't even want to say that the other side is anti-American by nature, but possibly anti-founding by choice, right? It's at any point, if they want to pick up the mantle again and start debating the Federalist Papers with us, I'm sure we'd be happy to do it. So that's one reason. And then the other reason is, I think that, you know, as Brand sort of alluded to, progressives are moving ever forward. I think they're ever narrowing. They're getting a increasingly specific set of not just goals, but beliefs and things that you have to say and do and think to be in their movement. And the penalties for not saying and doing and thinking these things are getting ever harsher and ever more punitive. And so I think that, you know, come on over, the water's warm. We will not fire you for something that you said when you were in high school.
I know you want to hear this, Tom, because you don't like the culture wars, but I would say, because we are the conservative movement in the Republican Party still is the party of faith, family, and freedom. And we're the party of religious liberty. We're the pro-life party. We're the party that trusts the American people.
Marisa.
I mean, how do I follow up? Everyone said it so beautifully. I think too, from a personal standpoint, as a conservative college student, I just see how we're different. We're treated so differently, and there is this fight for free speech that Mary Claire has talked a lot about. And I think there's something to be said to be the party that's encouraging dialogue, an actual dialogue, not one side telling the other. And I think that's very important that, Republicans are the party that we do want to have conversation. We're not asking that we have our views pushed onto the other side. We just want to have a conversation. So I think one thing that really draws me to the Republican Party, especially seeing it on a college campus for 4 years, granted Holy Cross is better than a lot of these other universities I've seen make the news, but we did have a protest with the Fenwick Review. But I do think everyone said it well, the freedom of speech issue, and but also just the values in place. As Professor Flaherty said, our values, I think, just are what I stand by. And on top of it, as I said, my personal experience being in college Republicans for 4 years, and I'm still going strong here, despite all the pushback, I think shows how Republicans do have better values than the media and the culture wars want to paint us as having.
Thank you. I appreciate your putting up with me for and our questions which came in, some of which were harder than my questions too, I'll admit. So, but it's good to see those I haven't seen in a while, and I appreciate your frankness in being here. So thanks very much, and thanks to our audience. Good night.